CUSA, the year in review. CUSA is the acronym for Concordia University Student Association. For a number of years, CUSA has operated within the university, serving the diverse needs of an ever-growing student population. As a CUTV effort to spotlight the significant contributions of CUSA this past year, we're presenting CUSA, the year in review. With me in the studio today are two members of CUSA, the outgoing co-presidents, David Baird and Lynn Keyes. Thank you for joining us. And to pose the questions, we'll be using a question and answer format today, are members of the student media. This is David Hunt, the editor of The Link. Beside him is Ted Wright, the news director for CRSG Radio. And beside him is George Kalogirakis, the editor of The Concordian. We'll start off the program with asking David and Lynn to sum up their impressions of the year, this past academic year, as CUSA co-presidents. Why don't we start with you, Lynn?
Contrary to what some people might think, I'm not completely disappointed with this year, despite the fact that there have been a lot of major issues, and in some cases these major issues have completely dominated the everyday workings of CUSA. I think we have accomplished a great deal this year. Unfortunately, not things that are particularly glamorous and that will get press coverage, therefore people don't really know about them. The big issues did take all the attention, which is unfortunate because it did draw energy away from people working on other projects and issues within CUSA. But overall, I'm satisfied with the work that my executives have done. Every year there are people who are very constructive and who do work a great deal, and there are others who aren't. That's par for the course. You can always expect that. But I think we have revitalized some departments, and I'm quite satisfied with that.
Okay, David, how would you like to sum up your past year as CUSA co-president?
My past year? Oh, dear.
Or CUSA's past
year,
for CUSA's that matter.
CUSA's past year? It's been a pretty interesting year. There's been some law problems that arose. Some we haven't handled that well. Some we did handle very well. There's been... looking over our whole year, I'm pretty well. Some parts of it I'm very proud of, and some parts I'm not very proud of. It's been, I would have to say, an inconsistent year, but I still have to say I'm pretty proud of it.
Okay. We're going to turn it over to the representatives from the student press right now. We've already decided on a format for questioning. We're going to go one round of questions, one question per each journalist, and each journalist will be allowed to ask a supplemental question. We'll start with you, David. Go to it.
Well, the success of any year's administration is usually determined in the long run by what new project it's initiated and special projects, not just from the how well it's coped with the day-to-day administration. What kind of things do you think CUSA has accomplished this year in terms of special projects and projects for the future that will have an effect in the future? And how much of those would you credit yourselves with, and how much of this is sort of the pet projects of the vice president?
You can divide that between yourselves to answer if you like.
Well, I think there are three very significant projects this year. The first one was obviously CUSA Core, and for all of its bad press, it is still a very sound idea, and it can be a very successful idea. There's no reason why we should not be allowed to run and coordinate our own food and beverage services. The second project that was rather successful, I believe, was the academic portion of our orientation program this year. We introduced well over anywhere between 1,000 and 2,000 new students to Concordia and to CUSA, and to the various problems they would face as a university student regarding things like registration and all of the administrative hassles that they might face. I believe we were very successful in that. And the third very good project has been our student advocate program, where students have the opportunity to be represented by the student advocate who will help them to deal with problems that they're facing in the university.
Have you got a supplemental to add to that, or you want to turn it over to Ted?
I'll go to Ted.
Okay, historically, apathy has been a great difficulty here at Concordia. What did you do as co-presidents this year to try to solve that?
Here. Apathy is just not a problem with us as in CUSA. It's also a problem within the other student service departments of this university. One of the things when I surveyed athletics is that found that there's a lot of people who are apathetic towards athletics. They really couldn't care. They didn't know anything. They really couldn't care. So that's one problem. Apathy just does not exist for CUSA, but exists for other areas. But what we do, I think in some areas, this is one part where we had an election orientation where we got a lot of people involved. And when students were brought in here, we gave them information concerning the university, concerning CUSA and all the things that they offered. We started off on a good foot, but I don't think we really answered. We didn't really come at that well later on in trying to get more students involved. The other thing I think we did well was there was a lot of new people who came into CUSA this year, and I think we did really look out for new blood, and we did get a lot of new blood into it. That was two things for any apathy. But we didn't pull any rabbits out of the hat and try to end it. We couldn't. It's a very difficult thing to end with this university, because this university, the hall building, for one thing, is structured to be an apathetic place.
Mm-hmm. Well, CUTV and CRHD did two informal surveys of during the CUSA elections on the second and third days. And in the first one, we had 11 out of 45 people said they would vote, had heard of the election, or had voted. And on the second day, it was 14 out of 60. Is there anything that you thought about trying and didn't try in this past year to solve the apathy, not counting the things you've already said?
Thought about trying?
Were there any things that came up that just didn't come down the tube after a while?
Not getting a newsletter published as much as we wish was one thing that was a bit disappointing to me.
I think in a excuse me, an attempt to come out looking good when we did good things wasn't. We didn't receive a lot of cooperation on that, i.e., when we did do something well, such as the academic orientation program or the student advocate program. It didn't receive a lot of press, and it should have. And on the other hand, from our own end of it, we didn't get the newsletter out as often as we should have, and we didn't really explore other areas of, publicizing what we do.
Okay. Excuse me. Okay. Now, George, we'll turn it over to you. You can choose person to direct your question to, or just throw it open to either of them.
I guess it's David. It must be David. It's almost the end of your year. I mean, you've got less than 2 weeks to run in your mandate. And there's one thing that has been, let's say, a shadow over your administration this year, and that's been the bribery charges that laid against David. And David, everything was done. Procedural problems sort of took away any need for you to answer the charges. And I'm wondering, before your mandate is up, would you like to answer them and, tell us what happened? Because it's been, nobody knows the entire story.
Well, George, I think I did answer them in my open letter to students, and I think that open letter states it pretty good. And if you want a bit more information, you can also read Glenn Murray's memorandum to the board, and that sums it up better than I think I could do it on the spot right now.
Well, why don't you give it a try?
Oh, dear. It's been such a long while since this all occurred, and the bribery charges, for one thing, answering the charge, I've gone through this so many times, and I wish not to do any more, but I'll try it. One thing was people's misunderstanding of what bribery is. No one really bothered to look it up or to see what it was, so they started to use the word rather liberally. And that caused a lot of problems. Of misappropriation funds, there was never any record of that. And contravening the bylaws of the association. That it was, I found, to be a pretty strange accusation, considering that if any time there's a confrontation between one student association and another, therefore the co-presidents can be therefore considered to not to be cooperating, and therefore contravene the bylaws of the association. It was a pretty strange way to accuse a person.
No, but I mean, a lot of people, when asked about what's happening, we did a survey ourselves on this topic, and a lot of people still had no idea what was happening. Mm-hmm. And don't you think, you know...
I don't know what's happening either.
Okay, that's your last supplemental. And that's your answer. Have we got enough time for another round of questioning? Okay, David, we'll throw it back to you.
Okay. It's been accepted pretty well that the board of directors didn't work this year. At least didn't work the way it should have. One side blames that on directors who are really more interested in their CVs and don't care about CUSA. And there's been another suggestion that maybe directors were turned off by the association because the association is so run by the executive, and they felt their input wasn't wanted. Would you want to address that? Whether
the idea that the association was so run by the executive really just astounds me, because if it was so run by the executive, well then we wouldn't have had the problem that we had with the trial. I mean, evidently the board of directors came out very strong in that one. And I think on various other occasions, you know, people do disagree on issues. And there are those who will vote one way and those who will vote the other way. If people vote to the same way as the co-presidents will vote, and in agreement with the executives, doesn't necessarily mean that we're ruling the board. We've had a great deal of difficulty getting board members to participate in policy making. When they are invited to contribute, very often we get nothing. We had very low attendance records for finance committee meetings. We wanted to revise the financial policies this year, but haven't been able to, because members of finance committee don't come to meetings after, you know, saying they will, or just plain they don't show up. I think there are people who attend board meetings and who you know, feel very much that the executive controls it, but yet they do still show up, and you know, they very often get their points across and get what they want. And I think there are, very clearly, I think there are other people who ran for election last year and who have attended maybe one or two board meetings and are very much interested in padding their CVs. And I have, you know, no problem with approaching those people and confronting them with that. Any supplemental?
Yeah, I just want to key in on one thing you said. Do you mean when you said that if the executives were on the association, the trials wouldn't have happened the way they did? Do you mean that the whole issue wouldn't have gone to trial?
No, I mean that if members of the executive had any attention paid to them at the November 12th board meeting, for example, when they were clearly trying to advise the board to do its job properly, i.e. to respect the bylaws, I don't think that, you know, that we would be in the legal mess that we're in for now, for one thing. And I think the same thing. No, I think the trial may well have gone on, but it would have gone on fairly.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's your end for the supplemental. Back to you, Ted.
Okay, now, first of all, I think that CUSA is difficult to run. I always laugh when I see people criticize, because it is difficult once you're on the inside. There wasn't that many. I mean, you might have had two or three crises in this last year. One of them was the engineering accreditation vote. Now, that happened, and like, why did it happen? Okay, and the supplemental to that is, let's hear a success story. I want to hear something good. I want to understand the engineering accreditation and what happened within CUSA and why it happened. But I also want to hear one thing that CUSA did that was really well, because, I mean, something must have happened that was good. So divide it up whichever way you choose.
You want to do the engineering?
Up to the engineers. Back in, was it November, I think the engineers were discussing among themselves to split from CUSA. And they decided to use Bill 32, which is the law concerning accreditation, passed in the summer of 83 by the PQ government. They decided to go on. They kept it pretty quiet. They said, you know, there's all these problems with CUSA, but they never came to see us and say, these are the problems. Then finally they started, it gets kind of confusing on the events that happened. What finally happened, there's a couple of people who decided, we're not members of the ECA executive, but are sort of like just right below, and they're always the volunteers and stuff like that for the ECSA. And they want to split from CUSA. They basically said finances, and that was basically close to it.
Yeah, the big issue was money.
We give you $83,000, therefore we should say how every single penny is spent. We said, well, you know, you do have engineer representatives on the board of directors who tell you, who are there to see how money is spent. They didn't really like that one. Then they, what happened is on a meeting that they were supposed to have an assembly concerning
microcomputers.
Suddenly, one engineer got up and started haranguing CUSA with all the everything that the Link had printed and then some more. And he and got the whole crowd riled up, and it's easy. It's rather easy to do. And so then they started this campaign and decided we have a mandate by the assembly to go off and go for accreditation, which they went and did. We had talked to them a few times about what they want and stuff like that. We didn't really get ever a rather sensible and logical list of things. They were rather convoluted, and they were not quite sure what exactly they wanted. And it was rather difficult to deal with that. Then the engineers suddenly decided to go off on accreditation, and they organized it in such a way that there would be no campaigning or very little campaigning to be done. And that's the way they organized themselves, and they got it passed, and that was it.
Okay. Well, let's watch the time limitation. You wanted to take the other half of that?
Success story. Well, we mentioned before the academic orientation program is very successful. The student advocacy program is successful. Within CUSA Central, I think our Vice President of Physical Resources, Stephen Blanchard, has done a tremendous job this year. It may not be a very glamorous position, and it's not something that gets a lot of attention, but I think that any of the member associations that he's dealt with, and he's dealt with just about all of them, I'm very satisfied with him. He's very very efficient, works very hard, he gets things done. He's brought back a department from near oblivion, 2 years ago to a very, you know, efficient and energetic department that it is right now.
Okay, we're going to move on to our final question from George, and we'd like to let you guys know to keep it brief. We want no more than 2 minutes per answer for the question. Okay.
Another thing that came out of the trials was, let's say, the inability of Judicial Board to do to function. Do you think that was a major problem? I mean, they were not able to take care of something as large as the trials against the co-president. And do you think this year was a crisis year for Judicial Board?
Oh dear.
David really shouldn't answer.
What? No. I've been sitting down discussing with Martin the role of Judicial Board in CUSA since about way before, back when I became co-president back in April. We have a tendency to disagree. I wonder about the Judicial Board's role, and I really think that they go overboard a lot, and therefore catch the association considerable number of get the association in a bit of trouble by doing so. Certain times I felt that the decisions they've made have been more of a destructive towards the association than they have been in another constructive action. And and their actions sometimes, could you repeat the question, George?
I'm just saying whether you think this was a crisis here because the Judicial Board has not been, was sort of consolidated last year. Given specific powers for 83, 84, and for 84, 85, it seems that they ran into something which they could not handle. Do you think maybe its power should be changed, curtailed?
No, I think that the Judicial Board members should really start to look at themselves a bit better. And reading through a few of the decisions, I don't really think that they understand what they actually do, and I think that they should be going through a bit more of a maturing process. The Judicial Board hasn't gone through that yet, and it still needs to.
Okay, that counted as your supplemental. In an attempt to present contrasting opinions on the issues, we went out among students to get their perspectives on what CUSA has done for the past year. We asked them three questions. We asked them to please, if they could, name what they thought was the highest profile CUSA programming event of the past academic year. We asked them who, in their opinion, was the most controversial CUSA board member, and, as well, who, in their opinion, was the most celebrated CUSA board member. If you can watch your monitors, let's take a look and see what we've got.
I don't know. I think the students that build up CUSA don't really show it enough, you know? We don't really know what's going on. Everything seems to be in their territory, not this every student, you know? So it's kind of lack of communication somewhere along the line.
I don't know nothing much about CUSA.
You always see some people in the papers, but you really don't know who they are, what they do. I guess I'm probably one of the many that, a good example of most of the students at Concordia that don't know, not every much, but little about the CUSA Association.
The carnival was pretty darn good. Yeah, a lot of, that was a good one.
Okay.
Everything in the carnival.
Okay, how about personalities? Who do you think would be the most controversial CUSA personality this past year?
That's a tough question. I guess David Baird, you know.
Okay, and how about the most celebrated in a positive kind of way?
David Baird. I like controversy.
I really don't know. I didn't get really involved in student politics and all of that. I have a lot of work to do, and I work a lot, so
probably the beer bashes.
Any particular ones stand out?
Not particularly. I don't have the opportunity to go to very many of them, but they're the ones that are advertised the most and maybe generate the most publicity.
And how about personalities? Who do you think would be the most controversial CUSA personality over the past year?
Definitely one of the co-presidents, Baird, I believe his name is. He seems to have generated the most press and generated the most media coverage, so to speak.
Okay, would you say this is a positive or a negative thing?
Definitely a negative thing. It doesn't reflect very nicely on CUSA. A lot of students feel that maybe they've been misled.
Okay, and let's talk about some positive things then. What about the most celebrated CUSA personality over the past year? In your opinion, who would that be, if you can think of one?
I can't really think of one because I'm not really familiar with all the, you know, personalities. I'm sure there are quite a few people who are doing a heck of a job, just that the scum seems to rise to the top, you know?
Okay. That's the last comment was purely editorial on the person we interviewed's opinion. This is a perfect segue into your response to that piece, bearing in mind that this is the first time that you've seen that piece. That's a student's point of view. Would you like to respond to it? Would you like to address students who may be watching this now and answer some of the kinds of questions that might have brought up?
Well, all I can say is, why aren't people reading the two student newspapers? Seems to me there is some coverage of what goes on in CUSA in there, so what's happening?
Okay. How about you, David? You have any words of wisdom for students that
words,
respond to that?
I didn't answer it just as well enough for me.
That's fine, eh? Well, that brings to a close today's segment, and we want to thank very much both David Baird and Lynn Keyes, the outgoing presidents of CUSA, for coming down to talk to us today. We appreciate it. We want to wish you well in all your future endeavors. We'd also like to thank the representatives of the student media. This is David Hunt from The Link, Ted Wright from CRSG News Director, and George Kolodziorakis, got the name right again, from The Concordian, for coming down and helping us out. Thanks. Join us again.